Good morning. I welcome you to St. John's today. Very happy to have you join us. I'm sorry we cannot be together in God's house yet. My wife Miggy was diagnosed with COVID a week ago Saturday. She's feeling much better, but still has a ways to go with her recovery. And thankfully, I have been tested and tested negative again, but that doesn't mean that we should probably mix very well until this is all over. So I'm not sure when we're going to be able to meet here in God's house again. I intend on calling the health department tomorrow and getting some clarification as to what I should be doing. This is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. This is the last green Sunday in Epiphany because next Sunday is the transfiguration of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the colors for the altar pyramids will change to white, and then we go into the season of Lent, which will be purple. We're going to begin by our organist, Jane Lopnow, playing her prelude called Light Preludium, which means easy prelude, by Albrecht Spurger. Worship today is a service of prayer and preaching found on Lutheran Service Book on page 260. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Sanctify us in your truth. Your word is truth. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Our first hymn is number 727, On Eagle's Wings, and Jane is going to play it through twice.
Thank you.
read aloud at home with me the words of the hymn, that the melody of which Jane just played. This comes from Isaiah chapter 40, which is the sermon text for today. I'm going to read the refrain only at the end after the verses. You who dwell in the shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life, say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day, though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The Old Testament reading and sermon text today comes from Isaiah chapter 40. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these, who brings them out of their hosts by number, calling them all by name. By the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on eagle's wings. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9. If I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but not of my own will. I am still entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my reward? That in my preaching I present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners compete, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. And so I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And the gospel reading is from the gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. Immediately, Jesus left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now, Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons, and the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because he knew them. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. Together we read the Ten Commandments. You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Join with me now in confessing the teachings of the Christian faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we pray together the Our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn is In Christ Alone. Amen. I invite you to read the words of the hymn with me. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. My dear friends in Jesus Christ, the text for our sermon today, as I indicated earlier, is from the Old Testament reading from Isaiah chapter 40. And there the Lord asks the question, do you not understand? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? He's asking about if they understand who he is and about his power and his might. If he created the heavens and the earth, then is he not able to guide and protect us? Is there anything that God isn't powerful enough to do? Well, of course, we know that God is omnipotent. That means he is almighty. And so we know that the answer is no. But yeah, if on February the 5th, 2017, you were a committed Christian and an equally committed Tom Brady, Bill Belichick, and New England Patriots fan, long about 8:13 left in the third quarter, you might have been experiencing a crisis of faith. Would God really be able to pull the Patriots out of a 28-3 deficit to the Falcons? Are there things that God can't do, like make the clock stop ticking, or make the Falcons fall down on their faces when they're on defense? Sitting on the edge of your couch, maybe you knew that God was able to pull it off, but the real question was whether or not he was willing to work the comeback. And there's the rub. How does God in his grand design govern football? Or even the greatest game of football at all, the Super Bowl? Well, if you ask me, I'm pretty sure that God is not a Patriots fan. Though people have called the Patriots Super Bowl 51 victory a miracle. But you got to remember, before that, there was the miracle on ice. And the book about the 1969 Mets in the World Series is called After the Miracle. No, we have questions about more important things than hockey or baseball or football. But the questions might be the same. When I really need something, when there's something that really matters, maybe something that seems like a really long shot, is God really able to help me? And maybe even more, is he willing to help me? Our text this morning gives us an emphatic yes to both. God as God is both able and he is willing to rescue his beloved people. Now, even before it happens, God answers Israel's wavering faith in his ability and willingness to keep his promises, in his ability to bring them back from the Babylonian exile after 70 years. The prophet Isaiah lived from about 740 to 681 BC, and he was the preacher to the kings in their courts in Jerusalem. His prophecies cover a period from 740 BC, when Uzziah dies, to the reign of Emperor Cyrus of Persia in 539 BC. And Isaiah, about 100 years before it takes place, when God uses Isaiah to prepare God's people for the coming Babylonian captivity, a time of exile, which lasted about from 586 BC to the rebuilding and the dedication of the temple in Jerusalem in 516 BC. He preached in the court of his king. He called his king and their family and other officers of the kingdom to repentance for their idolatry and their disregard for God's law. God's people, you see, had become unfaithful through their syncretism. That's not a word that we use every day, but syncretism means that they had incorporated the religion of their neighbors, its practices and their theology, and thus bringing upon themselves God's horrible judgment, so that they came to the point where they were tempted to doubt the Lord's ability to do anything at all. Could their Lord, Yahweh, really save them? Would he save them? Would he be their savior? After all, that's what the word Yahweh means. So when all hell breaks loose and many of God's people are transported, relocated to a foreign land called Babylonia, when the temple is destroyed, it would seem on the surface that the Lord was actually defeated by the gods of Babylon, that he was not powerful enough to save his people. Or when all this happens, they began to think that their God, Yahweh, had really abandoned them, that he isn't willing to save them. And so Yahweh provides an answer in their weakness and faithfulness and their doubts, reminding them that he is both infinitely able and he, in his love, is willing to rescue them and to bring them back to their homeland and guard and keep them as his beloved chosen people. God gently chastises and warns them. Don't you remember what I've been saying to you from the beginning? I am the Lord. I am the incomparable God, creator of heaven and earth, the true king of all of the kings of the earth. And so, of course, I am able. You know, it's kind of like asking, what part of who I am don't you understand? And then he encourages them, wait for me, trust me, and I will give you strength. For despite how things look, and I know they look bad, I have spoken. I will never abandon you. I already know. I've already set in motion my plan for how I'm going to bring you back from Jerusalem as I promised. And initially, it would be through the Persian Emperor Cyrus. But the Lord promises his ultimate servant who will rescue and protect them forever, giving them back double blessing for their iniquity. A little later in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah speaks for God, comfort, comfort my people, speak tenderly to Jerusalem, for she has received double for all of her iniquity. Our dear Heavenly Father answers in our weak and tempted faith. He answers, I'm willing, I'm able to rescue and preserve you, my beloved Israel, my church. We, like Israel, face temptations to doubt that God is able and willing to rescue us and strengthen us. It might on the surface look as if God's church is failing. Congregations are shrinking. our culture is more and more hostile to God's word, which calls us to repent of our sins and then to have faith in Jesus for restoration. It's not enough to have godless immorality shoved down our throats on TV shows and in the news and the movies and music. Ungodliness is championed by big corporations and big tech, so that if you are not sufficiently on board with same-sex unions or transgender rights or the social justice issue of the day or taxpayer-supported abortion, then you are likely to be called out, canceled, doxxed, terminated, labeled a bigot and a hate monger. You see, the language of our culture is not the language based on the Ten Commandments and our redemption through the blood of Jesus Christ or the cross or the recognition that life is holy from the moment of conception to the time that we reach the grave. But no, we are more concerned with hearing the stock market report of our investments than we are in being concerned that law and gospel is preached properly in our churches. America is becoming more and more like a Babylonian captivity, where we find ourselves in a foreign land with a foreign language and foreign customs and foreign gods. And if we become comfortable with it, and we have become comfortable with it, then we've got a problem. We are also tempted to believe that God needs our help, our wisdom or strength to rescue and revive his church, so that rather than returning from our idolatry and our complacency, we think that if we can just convince our national, state, and local legislators to enact certain laws, and if we can elect the right president and governor, then it will secure our investments and retirement funds. And we can just sit back and enjoy, and that's the most important thing of all. We are even tempted to simply just give up on the culture around us. Just shrug our shoulders and be quiet. Try to keep our heads low. Try to not bring attention to ourselves and get on with life the best that we can. Giving into the culture might mean for a young couple living together before marriage because, well, everybody's doing it. And giving into the culture might mean that their parents will never say anything to their children when they do that. That's giving into the culture. Giving into the culture around us might mean adopting the language of evolution rather than using the language of God creating all things through his word, which he spoke at the very beginning. Giving into the culture might mean adopting the language of critical race theory that pits race against race and divides everyone into either the oppressed or the oppressor. My friends, I have news for you. Just as the children of Israel were not able to avoid the tidal wave of Babylonian military and exile, neither can we avoid the onslaught of our culture. We cannot think that we'll just be able to bury our heads and think the idolatry of the culture around us will never affect us. Because at one time or another, in one place or another, when it comes to one issue or another, the monitors of our godless society, who control what speech and behavior is acceptable, will try to tell you. They will try to tell you what is acceptable to say and what is not, and what you must do to be accepted or to prosper or not. And if you doubt me, just ask yourself what you are not allowed to say or do for fear of losing your job or a friendship or your reputation if you confess Christ in his word. Oh, but God knows our need. And he has prepared his answer from before the foundations of the earth. And that answer is the Christ, Jesus. He gently chastises us for our lack of faith. Do you not know? Has it not been told you from the beginning? In other words, do I have to say it again? I am the Almighty Creator, whose word is unbreakable. God is our true King, even of our own nation, whether he is acknowledged by its people or its leaders or not. He is able, and he rules over all, specifically for the sake of his church, and that means for us. He raises up political leaders, and by his breath, he brings them to nothing. He comforts and strengthens us today with his word of rescue, the word that extends to us the forgiveness of sins. And when we're able to receive it, we receive that forgiveness in the body and blood of his Son in the Holy Sacrament. For Jesus is that suffering servant who paid for our iniquity, who exchanged our weakness for his strength and our sin. We get his righteousness. For our sake, the Father heard his cries and did not come to his rescue, but let him endure all of the pain of the cross to the point of death and burial before he raised him from the dead. And so God is therefore able and willing to rescue us from every threat and every need that we face. Is it ongoing guilt for something that we've done in the past that haunts us? Is it the loss of a spouse? A medical diagnosis that proves to us that we're not in control of life? For Isaiah and the prophets, God promised to rescue them from the kings and the people to whom they preached, even if that rescue came after they died. And they died. In the time of the apostles in the early church, God's people professed Christ as Lord, and they counted on the promises of God to rescue them from death that came by flames or by wild animals. Millions of Christians around the globe died for the sake of Christ. Many millions more suffered hardship and hunger and joblessness and rejection and exile and relocation to foreign lands for Jesus' sake in the 20th century alone. Often powerless to change their circumstances, they trusted in the God who created heaven and earth to vindicate their cause and lead them home. And God gave them strength to endure, sometimes to the point of death, rather than deny Christ, the Son of God, the one that the Father sent from heaven for our rescue. God's promise is ours. They who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Here in time, hidden in the midst of weakness and exile. But finally, that promise leads us to our heavenly home where we will be with him forever. His ability to show mercy to those whose hope is in the Lord, whose hope is in his steadfast love, is matched by his willingness to carry out that mercy. Amen. And the peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our prayers are the responsive prayers today. And noting that in those prayers, I will ask blessings upon my dear Miggy. And we will also ask blessings upon the family of Chuck Arnold, our member here, who was struck by a tree yesterday as he was cutting the tree down. And the Lord decided that this was the time that he would take him to his heavenly rest. And so we pray for Carolyn and the rest of Chuck's family. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Your Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord, is the great physician of body and soul, at whose command demons flee. Disease and every ill effect of sin must turn away. We bring before you those in any need, including Norb Walther, Bob Acton, Mark Walther, who have been hospitalized lately. We pray for Miggy Carnahan as she recovers from COVID, Kevin Law and Norman Carnahan in their ongoing struggle with cancer, Susan Miller as she awaits surgery this week, Sandy Denny as she awaits the results of tests, Patty Byrne and Alvin Walther as they undergo treatments. Lord, give them strong faith that in the strength you provide, your servants may rise up on eagle's wings and not grow weary as they await the rescue that you have promised in Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, grant that same strength to the family of Chuck Arnold, his wife Carolyn, their children and grandchildren, whose Lord, you saw fit that Chuck would enter into his eternal rest yesterday. Be merciful now to his family in their grief. Sustain them in the hope of the resurrection unto everlasting life and a joyful reunion in heaven, where there is no more pain or tears or death, but only unending joy and peace. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Finally, for these and all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. O Lord, keep your family, the church, continually in the true faith, that relying on the hope of your heavenly grace, we may ever be defended by your mighty power. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please pray with me. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger, and I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings in life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless us and preserve us. Amen. And our final hymn is Go My Children With My Blessing, number 921 in Lutheran Service Book. Please read the words with me. Go, my children, with my blessing, never alone. Waking, sleeping, I am with you. You are my own. In my love's baptismal river, I have made you mine forever. Go, my children, with my blessing, you are my own. Go, my children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Here you learned how much I love you, what I can cure. Here you heard my dear son's story. Here you touched him, saw his glory. Go, my children, sins forgiven, at peace and pure. Go, my children, fed and nourished, closer to me. Grow in love and love by serving, joyful and free. Here my spirit's power filled you. Here his tender comfort stilled you. Go, my children, fed and nourished, joyful and free. I, the Lord, will bless and keep you and give you peace. I, the Lord, will smile upon you and give you peace. I, the Lord, will be your Father, Savior, Comforter, and Brother. Go, my children, I will keep you and give you peace. I thank you for joining us today for our worship at St. John's Lutheran Church in Lanesville, Indiana. And we pray it's been uplifting to you and will give you strength to persevere. Whatever challenges that you have going on in your life right now, and ultimately to give you strength to reach your heavenly homeland, where we will dwell in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ forever and ever. Please watch the news. You can find, I'm sure you'll be able to find the information about services for Chuck Arnold at one of the funeral homes. I'm not sure which one that is going to be yet, but as that information becomes available, we'll try to send that out to the membership of St. John's Lutheran Church, as well as to post it on our Facebook page and on our web page. Jane is now going to play the postlude called, Matt reminds me that if you need an offering statement for the year 2020, just call the church office or email the church office, and we'll make sure that you get that if you need that for your taxes. Jane's going to play the postlude called La Morisque by Susato.